instead of bringing in accountants to see where we could cut back and try to make ends meet, the first item of business of the General Conference in 1903, in this time of great crisis, was to take the delegates back to the Word of God. They all gathered and went back to the Word of God. And to find out and to remember what the mission of the church was. History tells us the General Conference Bulletin says that for three separate meetings, the church took their Bibles and turned to the book of Revelation, chapter 14. They knew where they were in history. They knew where they were in time. They knew what was going on. Revelation chapter 14, verse 6 through 12. And this is what we call the three angels' message. And reminded themselves why they were there. What we were as a church. What was our purpose? What was our destiny? For three sessions, they went back to the Word of God and studied to look, and they remembered what their mission was. You know, not too long ago, I just said to someone, wouldn't it be great? You know, we have this wall right here behind us. We have this wall right here behind us. And behind this wall, there's a hallway that goes from the secretary's office to the pastor's study, for those of you who have never been back there. And then above that is a whole bunch of big glass windows. So you can see right into the hallway, not actually the hallway, but it's up high enough above the hallways. But you can see there's space between this wall and that wall. And I said, wouldn't it be awesome if we had stained glass windows right here and the light coming through, shining with the three angels? Many of our churches have those. And then I read this and it made me feel ashamed of myself. It says, we etched the three angels' message in these beautiful stained glass windows. Many churches have them etched in their windows. We even have them artistically embossed in our logo as a church. And I've seen beautiful pulpits with the three angels right here engraved in the pulpits. We talk about them, we throw the words around, the three angels this, the third angel this, the second angel that. But do we really understand what we're saying? Tragically, I need to say that most Adventists, if you were to ask them, what is the second angel's message? What is the third angel's message? And in fact, more fundamental question is, so what do they mean? How many of us here would really be able, if someone came up to you and said, what is the first angel's message? Now, I'm just going to make a short comment here. There's three prophets that served God for 70 years that we know of. One of them was Daniel, one of them was John, and the last one we believe was Ellen G. White. And do you know what they all dealt with? They all dealt with the end time events. That should tell us something. That's why she says so many times we should be studying the books of Daniel and Revelation together. Because if you only study one, you're getting half of the story. We need to study both. But yet, in these three angels' message lies the reason why we are here. Who are we? Who are we? Who are we? In these three angels is the core, the foundation of the witness and the message that we are called to share. You see, we are called to trumpet these messages at this time in world's history, when as never before, modern society is lulled to sleep by their own accomplishments. And we are so enamored with our own scientific knowledge, and we are so put at ease with our entertainment industry, that in many Adventist pulpits, unfortunately, these trumpets of the three angels are silent. Can anybody agree with me on that one? We are so enamored with the world's pleasures that it has to offer us that it's boring to sit down and study our Bibles. Can you excuse me just for one moment? My mouth is just really getting dry. I'm sorry to interrupt you like that. Unfortunately, these trumpets of the three angels have fallen silent, at times replaced for a kind of pop psychology, a desire to fit in with the general Christian community. Brothers and sisters, we're supposed to be different. Unfortunately, you know, my sister just passed. We mentioned that before already. And I hear phrases like, well, she's in a better place. Even from my own family members, she's in a better place. Who wants to be buried in a bunch of dirt and say, well, that's a better place? But they're referring that she's gone to heaven. You know, it's a beautiful thought. You know, it's a beautiful thought. But that's not where she is. She's resting, waiting for the second coming. There's often a move to become a generic denomination. I heard one of our members say one time, oh, the 23,000 days, you know, whatever that is. And you know, it hurt me so bad, because we were given that message to tell to the world. Unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. And at the end of that 2,323 days, the judgment began. We need to be letting the world know the judgment is going on. Many believe that when he comes, that's when he's judging the world. But it's not. The judgment is already finished. And are we forgetting to tell that to the world? I'm going to read these next two paragraphs in the first person, because it's an experience that this man had. He says, you know, ma'am, you know, I remember playing a game called Risk. How many remember that game, Risk? Yeah, several of us have played it, I'm sure, as a kid. Risk is really an interesting game. And when my kids got older, we were living in Hong Kong. We went out and bought the game of Risk for them. Now, the game of Risk, this one at least, was written in Chinese. But they knew how to play it. I'll bet you don't have one of those in your home written in Chinese, but this is a game of Risk. And the idea of Risk is that you have a map and you try to conquer the world. But when we bought this new version of Risk, I came across the realization that they had added a few more dimensions to this game. Before you start, you take this card, and this is your mission. And then the one who fulfills that card, they win the game. I remember when I first came face to face with this little card, it hit me, and it hit me hard. It was one of those aha moments. Interesting how the Lord speaks through different voices, because it was a Risk game that talked to me that day. And I said, you know, this is exactly what the concept of the remnant is. as a church, as a movement of history, God has handed us a special mission card. And he's saying to us as a movement, as a church, I want you to proclaim the three angels' message. The three angels' message to prepare the world for my soon coming. That's our mission. Becoming a Seventh-day Adventist is not a free ticket to heaven. Just because we've become a Seventh-day Adventist does not guarantee us heaven. But when we become Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we should become missionaries. We become ministers of the gospel because God has given us a special message. Becoming a Seventh-day Adventist, having your name on some church books, does not make holy a person. So whether our names are on these books or some other books, it doesn't make us holy. It doesn't give us a free ticket. Where should our names be? Where should our names be? What book? The Lamb's Book of Life. That's where our name should be. So take your Bibles with me, and let's turn together again to Revelation 14, chapter 14, and we're doing this in the hopes that we will each understand the meaning behind these messages, that we will become more committed than ever to proclaim them personally to this world in which we live. I can remember, I had a Bible at home, and in the back of that Bible, about this much of it, I don't know if you can see that, but that's, my pages are thin, but that's quite a few pages. And they used to hand those out at evangelistic meetings. And the evangelistic meetings, they covered almost every topic in this Bible study in the back of your Bible. And I'll tell you, what I'm talking today is just barely touching the surface of just this one message of the three angels. I always tell myself, someday I'm going to use, I tore it out of the Bible. The Bible fell apart and I kept that back section because it's got the old Advent teachings in it. But let's go back to Revelation 14. Verses 6 to 12. And another angel, I'm sorry, okay, you will see that the word worship is used seven times in this theme. It is the main issue at the end of time. And is that true? It is the main issue, isn't it? It's going to be worship. We either worship Satan or we worship God. The first angel clearly reminds us that we are to worship none other than Him who is the Creator God Himself. And so the preaching of this everlasting gospel is intertwined with worship. And notice it says it's preaching the everlasting gospel. How long is everlasting? I think it's the same gospel that Adam and Eve got in the Garden of Eden. It's the same gospel that Moses was given there in the desert when they were told to build the sanctuary. This is the same gospel that Jesus proclaimed of the kingdom of God. This is the same gospel that Peter and Paul proclaimed. It's the gospel summarized in John chapter 3, verse 16, that anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved because of his son, Jesus Christ. In fact, I believe that Revelation 14, verse 6 and 7, the first angel is a fulfillment of the promise given by Jesus himself in Matthew 24, where it says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached unto the whole world, and then the end will come. Now, what's our message? What's our job? What are we supposed to be doing? We're supposed to be preaching the gospel, aren't we? Worldwide. Instead of, and I hope I don't step on anybody's toes, instead of being bench warmers. You know, no matter who we are, we can come in contact with somebody. I got to share with a man down in Garberville here a while back. And he was a transporter. Now, I don't know if you know what that is, but he transported marijuana. And he says to me, I know the end's got to be near. And you know, that opened up, that gave me a chance to open up to him. His name was Chris, and I says, Chris, you're right. I says, the end is very near. And I says, and you know what else? He goes, what? He says, what you're doing is wrong. He says, I know. He says, but I kind of rationalize it. And I talked to him about how sin started in heaven. And Adam and Eve, the fall, Lucifer, the whole thing. And he looked at me and he says, I've got to go home and tell my wife. And I thought, oh my. You know, I've never had that response before. He says, I've got to go home and tell my wife. And then out of the blue, his wife had a very rough life too. Out of the blue, he says to me, he says, I met my wife at a brothel. And I thought, oh my, she has had a hard life too. So I'm just praying that he does what he says. He's going to go home and tell his wife, you know, that there's something better. That there's something better. We can plant a seed, is what we can do. Here is an end-time movement preaching that very same gospel right here before the second coming of Christ. And this gospel will be preached into the whole world, and then the end will come. So why is it that we are to fear God? Why does this message call us out to fear God? The reason is because the hour of his judgment has come. Now, we as Seventh-day Adventists, if we understand this judgment rightly, we know that the judgment is in our favor, is in his people's favor. And I said Seventh-day Adventists, but it's in favor of God's people. So we do not need to be afraid of the judgment. We should be searching our hearts, you know, so we can be ready. But that judgment is in our favor. It's now, it's going on, and we understand that that judgment hour message began there at the end of the 2300 days prophecy. Remember I read that? And that's when it began. And you know, it's interesting that when you go back and you look at Adventist history, now when I say Adventist history, we're going back before Seventh-day Adventists. They were called Adventists in the 1840s, 43s. They were from every denomination because they had accepted the message that Jesus was coming, and so they called them Adventists. And you know, it's interesting, as we go back and we look at the history, that you see this first angel's message begin to be preached there in 1843 as William Miller and those Adventists understood what this was, that Jesus was coming soon, that there was a judgment, that Christ needed to be preached and his soon coming proclaimed to everyone, far and near. And I believe that we need to continue to sound that message today. Now see, this is where they got mixed up. With the message. They were preaching that Jesus was coming. The judgment was coming. But they didn't realize that it was just the judgment that was coming. So they had the date right, but they had the event wrong in 1843 and 44. So they went back and they studied some more. And then the second angel's message, there was an invitation to abandon all false pretenses of worship, to turn aside from that which is wrong, to turn aside from that which is man-made, and to turn to God. When we submit ourselves to God, we leave the world behind. Is that true? That's very true. The closer you come to God, the more you hate the world or the things that are in the world. You see how they contradict with God's character, and you say, I don't want to have any more part of that. And so we, little by little, we get away from those. Sometimes we can do it just wham. You know, it just depends on how God is able to work with us. We need to turn aside from the world and its teachings. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about Babylon. It says this word Babylon is interesting. The first place it's mentioned in Revelation is right here. It says Babylon is often referred to or associated with the idea of confusion. Where do we get the idea of confusion? What was the first story? I can't hear you. The Tower of Babel. That's right. Now, do you know how long it was from the time of Noah when the boat landed into the Tower of Babel was? Anybody have an idea? 100 years. They had already turned their back on God 100 years later. Can you imagine how Noah must have felt as he saw his children and his grandchildren rejecting God again and building a tower because they didn't trust him? They didn't believe what he said.